I'll begin this a short comment. You never know, there may be others entering later. My name is Dirk van der Marel. I'm Dutch by origin. Ik ben Nederlands. Je suis aussi professeur à l'Université de Genève. Und ich bin auch Ratsmitglied der Schweizerische Forschungsgemeinde in Bern. But here I'll speak English on the occasion of giving a talk in the Netherlands. But just to be sure, who of you does not speak or understand Dutch? Okay, in that case, we'll just stick to English indeed. The way you have organized these courses is there, in principle, there are four slots possible. If I get no questions of you at all, then we'll go through all four slots. Now, to avoid that, you may pose many questions and actually as many as you like. And so I'll try to look around and keep a keen eye on you. If there are signs of fatigue or falling asleep, of course, but also if there are signs of something not understood, I'll try to hold and see if you can do something about it. Nonetheless, to have some idea of your background, I mean, you may have an idea of my background. I'm a person who has worked all his life in condensed matter physics, and a good part of my life did optical spectroscopy, but also other things in condensed matter physics. But I have no idea, of course, who you are and what you are. And now I'm not going to listen to 25 resumes of your, but you can do it by handwriting. So who of you are physicists? So that's okay. Let's simmer down. So who of you, you're not?
I'm half of physics.
The other half?
Half physics, half chemistry.
Okay. So who of you works on materials or on whatever, solid state physics or so? Okay, that's all. And who does not? Okay. So just what is it that you work on?
Integrated optics.
Oh, okay. Optics at least. And you?
Yeah, development of magnetic resonance force microscope.
Okay, yeah. And you?
Diffusion of light in materials that they
Okay, so things with optics on there. So at least there's some overlap. But you may have some. You will learn. You may learn a lot, probably. But it's probably the same for you. So I'll start with a few relatively old things, but not necessarily very simple things. And that is, I'll talk initially about insulators and about interactions between particles that you have in insulators and how those actually give rise to things that are known as excitons, and I'll try to make a case why this is important. This is part one. There's also part two, which is about excitons and superconductors or something similar like that. I think by then, when we're through, we have our break. And after that, there are two more subjects I'll tell you about that later. But all of these things, also these later subjects, have to do with the fact that in materials, usually particles are different than in vacuum because of interactions of some kind. Now, I'll begin with optical conductivity. Now, in the electromagnetic field, if you do optical conductivity, you are shining light on samples or through samples. You absorb light or you refract light or you do nonlinear optics with light. In any case, the electromagnetic field couples to every charged particle, but it involves charge, obviously. Without that, it wouldn't couple. Now, different particles may have different charges. Usually, we think in terms of the elementary charge, but we'll see through this talk that it doesn't always have to be the elementary charge. So that's why we use the general symbol Q of mu. In any case, it can be plus or minus an elementary charge, but sometimes also twice that or three times. And then the current of such a particle with a charge Q, where mu, in this case, refers to the kind of particle. So later on, we'll call, it will be E for an electron, for example. Then the current that is associated with that is the velocity of your particle multiplied by the charge. And if you want to be really precise, and you say the current density, well, you have to multiply with the density of those particles. And so the coupling to the electromagnetic field is described by a term in Hamiltonian, which is minus the vector potential times this current. There are more terms. There's also an A square kind of term that we won't say much about. I wouldn't say it's not important, but it's not important for what I have to say. Now, we see do a lot with the linear response in this talk. And the linear response, and this goes a little fast. I know it's a bit of formality right in the beginning. Later on, it will ease up. Hello? Is the optical conductivity is sigma. And the real part of it is usually what we are talking about if we talk about the optical conductivity depends on frequency. And actually, this frequency dependent is all depending on this here. This is a current, and that's a current, and these are actually current operators. If you do quantum mechanics, you express things in terms of operators. This is an operator of the current at time t. This is the one at time zero. The commutator of those two, so this one times that one minus this one times that one, is not zero usually because they don't have to commute. And then you get a finite expectation value of this average over here. You Fourier transform to for a certain frequency, and so you calculate what its projection for a certain frequency is, and that gives you the conductivity for a given frequency of your light. So this is the completely general and formal definition. As long as you're talking about one kind of particle, there's a Q, which is mu, over here, Q mu. So what if you have more than those? Well, if they don't interact, then it's very simple. You could just think of it as having several of these particles next to each other, and each of them carries a current. Since they don't interact, you just take the conductivities of them in parallel, because they will be like parallel resistors, actually. Okay, so that's easy enough. But of course, usually they do interact, and then you have to generalize this a little bit, and you get something else. And so you start actually a different way. You say, okay, the operator for the total current is the sum of all of those contributions. We call that capital J. And now all we have to do for the optical conductivity is to calculate the commutator of capital J at time t and with the one at time zero, so the sum of all these things. And now if you think of it, there's actually a sum over terms of J mu and J nu, and they can be the same, but they don't have to be the same. And so there are also commutators here involving the commutation of different particles. Now, if they don't interact, those commutations would be zero. But if you have interactions, then those commutators are not zero. And sorry, there should be an expectation value around, an expectation bracket around it. So if that's not zero, if they interact with each other. That's actually what interaction does, one of the things which it does. And so one of these things, and that is what I'm going to hammer on today, is if you have interaction between particles, and sometimes these particles form clusters. And I give you a few examples of those just to make it concrete for you. And then you can immediately see if they form clusters, then actually makes a lot of sense that you actually think in these terms of these combined currents, because it's just these particles moving together. So some examples would be helium-3, that's a cluster. It's not charged, but the components of helium-3 are charged, and so together they have zero charge. In the end, once the atom is formed, it doesn't couple to light anymore. Although, actually, there are seven particles in there, helium-4 also, of course. There are seven, in this case, particles in there. Each of those, no more, well, there's a whole bunch of particles, and all of them are charged. Not seven, actually. And, no, except the neutrons, who are not. But if you put them together, it is neutral. Yeah? Or a Cooper pair, you have a question.
Yeah, so it's a bit confused. We're talking about currents and conductivity.
Yeah.
So why is this called optical conductivity? So we're not talking about light, but really about B times a current.
Well, a current at a certain frequency actually corresponds to a induced polarization, if you wish, also at the same frequency, and that influences all the optical properties. Yeah, yeah. So actually, this sigma of omega shows up, and I'll show many examples of it, essentially as the absorption of light. So what's absorbed doesn't go through or is not reflected. And so that gives you indeed a colorization of your samples. So really, because you have these currents here, and if these oscillate at a certain frequency omega, then it actually contributes to the sigma of omega. Now, of course, if these particles form clusters and they are neutral, then you don't see them anymore. And that's sort of interesting, because they're still there, but the optics doesn't see them anymore, at least not in certain frequencies. So that's the case for helium-3. If they form Cooper pairs, you might want to see them. Cooper pairs are pairs of electrons that enter in the superconductor. Ions, if you have a solid, is electrons and nuclei, which are bound together to form ions. Or excitons, I'll talk about those, which are also neutral and have certain properties, certain interesting optical properties. Now, if the excitation energy of those objects is small, we'll see it in data later, then the energy that binds this cluster together, then the conductivity, this conductivity here, is carried by the clusters. It involves just the clusters themselves or maybe internal properties of those clusters. If the excitation energy is larger than the binding energy of the cluster, then the energy is big enough to just splatter them apart. And by that time, you start to actually see a conductivity which is carried by the individual particles. So to give, to let you make this whole thing a little bit sense is the following. Imagine that you are hiking somewhere in a field, a grass field, and there are cows in the far corner of this field. And suddenly you will realize that those cows, five of those cows, are actually running in your direction. Now, you could say, okay, what should I do? Well, I first calculate the equations of motion of all the molecules and atoms in those cows, and then of the five cows together, and then I'll see what is the best course of action. Or you might think, okay, there's 4,000 kilograms of beef going in my direction at 20 kilometers an hour. That's a lot of kinetic energy, actually, if you think of it. And I mean, I don't have to do the calculation to realize that the best action is probably to step aside a little bit and let them pass. These are examples where actually it's sometimes smarter not to look at the individual particles, but really at the combined particles, if you're talking about energies small enough that the clusters don't fall apart. Of course, if the cows are going so fast that they would actually splatter in their molecular components by the time that they crash into you, maybe you would have to do the full calculation of the individual particles. But otherwise, you wouldn't. You wouldn't do that normally. Okay. So again, optical conductivity. So I gave you this formula, where now the sum is over the indices mu and nu of the different particles. Or it could even be the same kind of particles, but at least not the same ones. Now, there is an F-sum rule, and we're going to use this a lot later on, which says that if you integrate over this optical conductivity, then it actually just tells you how many particles there are of each kind. So there's a universal factor, prefactor, pi over 2. There's a mass factor, which depends on the mass of each of these particles in the denominator. There's the charge of the particles over here. So if there are neutrons in your system, you wouldn't see them because they have no charge. They don't contribute here. And there's the number of those particles, or actually it's the number density of each of those particles of type mu. Now, if you apply this formula to, let's say, lithium or any kind of solid, which has electrons and nuclear particles in it, then you should remind that the nuclear particles are about 1,800 times heavier than an electron. And typically, you have about 2 nuclear particles for every electron because most of the atoms have 1 neutron, 1 proton, 1 electron, roughly. So actually, the number of the mass involved in the nuclei is 4,000 times bigger than the total mass in the electrons. That goes in the denominator. So actually, everything that comes from the nuclei over here is 4,000 times smaller than the electrons. That doesn't mean that it is not important at all, but it is actually quite small as compared to the electrons. So this here is vastly dominated by the electronic contribution. Yes?
How is it possible that this F-sum rule does not consist any information about the correlations itself? Intuitively, it sounds really strange.
Yeah.
Because, for example, two charged particles can interact using the neutron.
Mm-hmm.
But still, this F-rule does not consist any information about this neutron
that
carried
so,
interaction.
Well, okay. So by integrating, of course, you integrate out a lot of information, and this would not be the only thing you do with a spectrum. So the full proof relies on nicely working out this commutator here, and you will see that it actually works. Now, the main reason actually why the interactions, for example, don't matter is actually the interaction part in the Hamiltonian commutes with the current. And so it's only the kinetic energy that interacts. And so the kinetic energy is, so let's say at least one of the reasons. You might think that somehow the correlation of the ground state has an influence on the sum rule. It doesn't. And but intuitively, you might, and we'll see examples of that too, you will actually find that, maybe it's better to look at the examples and come back to this question. So now, before we do that, a little bit about some experimental techniques. This is the only slide where I'll talk about it, how it's done. And there are many ways to do this kind of, but usually the objective of doing the linear spectroscopy in optics, crudely speaking, is you want to calculate, you want to measure sigma of omega, usually the real part and the imaginary part. How do you go about it? Okay, the usual step is, often at least, you start by measuring the reflectance as a function of frequency. Here it's plotted. This is hardly visible because it's a very old paper from 1980. This was even a copy of earlier results. Starts at 10 minus 1 electron volt up to 10 to the fourth of aluminum. And this aluminum is a good reflecting material. It's used as mirrors, and so it has 100% reflection up to about 10 electron volt. Then it starts dropping and goes, you have things, there are dips here. I'll come to it, what those dips are. And this is your reflectance spectrum. You try to measure it as far as you can, actually from zero to infinity. Why is that? But you can't, of course. Because in order to calculate the optical conductivity, you also need to know the phase of reflectance. And that is more difficult to measure. Although nowadays there are techniques to measure it, but they are not very precise. And so typically what one does is one uses Cramer-Kronig relations between the phase and the logarithm of the reflectance. And so if you have the entire reflectance spectrum, you can get also from that the entire phase spectrum. Cramer and Kronig, they were in Leiden and in Delft many, many years ago, and they invented this thing. Very beautiful. Okay, so in your phase, so if you know the square root of reflectance and the phase factor, you just plug them into the relations that were found by Fresnel somewhere in the 19th century. You invert it, and it tells you that n plus I kappa, which is the refractive index plus the extinction coefficient, n plus I kappa equals 1 minus the reflectance coefficient, including phase, divided by 1 plus that. So it's an easy calculation. So that's actually shown here for the case of aluminum. You see there are some dips and bumps there at the same places where you have it. Also the reflections of all these curves already look very different. And then you feed this information into the formula that we owe to, well, whatever, the standard formula of Fresnel also, I guess, is the real part of the optical conductivity, is the frequency times n times kappa over 2 pi. It's the angular frequency over 2 pi. You put it all together, and this now is the optical conductivity as a function of photon energy. From 10 minus 2, so 10 milli electron volt, up to 1,000 electron volt. This here is the Drude peak. Then there's stuff over there. We'll come to the precise indications of those different contributions. Yes?
So, in 3, you start with the reflective index and the complex index of the
torsion,
and then from the
middle,
the 3.
Yeah, you have n plus I kappa. Those are actually calculated from this formula. So this is measured. This is the only thing that is measured. You feed it into Cramer-Kronig, you get phi. So phi is not shown here, but you get it.
Yeah.
You put that together, you get n plus I kappa. So for one component, you get now 2. And you put it together back, and you get sigma. That's it. This is for reflectance. You have similar kind of expressions if you want to do similar kind of analysis on transmission or on an energy loss spectroscopy. Yes?
I'm also curious about phi. You said that it's hard to measure.
Yeah.
But actually, if you can get it from R, why not to measure R and then find phi?
That's what I say. So you measure R, you feed it into Cramer-Kronig, and you get phi.
But then what is the reason that people want to measure directly phi?
Well, the reason is, you need to know R from 0 to infinity. But nobody ever can measure from 0 to infinity. So in order to do it, you have to make some physical assumptions about what happens below and above your window of observation. You can do pretty good things there, though. And so in the end, you normally would find. In fact, normally, I don't do it this way in my lab. So I use a combination of ellipsometry and reflection spectroscopy, or just ellipsometry. And then we get this without any kind of those information. But this debate was done at that time in 1980 by Shiles. Okay, so here again, it's the same optical conductivity, Shiles and company, aluminum on a very broad range. And there's something interesting about it. Here you have the intravalence band. So this is what happens inside. Well, this is the so-called Drude peak. It's the electrons that are excited just across the Fermi energy. It's just the metallic response. So it's centered at zero frequency. Of course, it's a log-log plot. If you have the width that you have over here, of this peak, has to do with the lifetime or the inverse lifetime of the electrons. So if it's a very dirty metal, this gets very broad. And if it's very clean or a superconductor, it gets very narrow. And then you have intervalence band stuff. So there are actually transitions between states in the valence band over here. Here you have the so-called L-edge. Now here we have a picture, a sketch of the aluminum atom. In the core, you have the 1s core level. Around it, you have the 2s and the 2p core levels. And then you have these valence states, which are 3s and 3p states. But of course, if you have many of these aluminum atoms together, they overlap. And you know, some of you know from your solid state courses that you get bands. And then maybe these quantum numbers of s and p are not so accurate anymore. But nonetheless, we keep using those. But certainly for the cores, it's a very good indicator. Now, sum rule says that if you integrate over all this, and we just look at the electrons here because of this factor 4,000 difference anyways, we can actually get the effective number of electrons by just inverting this formula. You integrate over sigma, you multiply with known factors, the free electron mass, this unit cell volume, divided by pi e square. This should give the number of electrons if you integrate from 0 to infinity. So it's actually interesting to see how that builds up if you go gradually to higher and higher frequencies. So you go through the intervalence band, you see the first rise. You have the intravalence band, there's a bit extra, and here you are at 3 electrons. Yeah? Now, why is that? In this shell, there are 3 electrons. And then you hit the 2D shell, the so-called L-edge, and it rises a bit more. It's because this peak over here, it rises to 11. Why is that? Because there are 8 electrons in this shell. So that makes 11 altogether. And then you go to the last bit, the highest energy bit, the deepest states, the 1s states. There are 2 electrons in there. And lo and behold, it adds up to 13. 2 plus 8 plus 3 is 13. This is precisely what you get. So this is actually a way to check also whether the entire spectrum has been correctly measured. If you screwed it up somewhere, you will not find the correct sum rule. This is precisely what Shiles did in his study, to check whether there were any discrepancies in the spectrum. And I mean, he had many sources, and based on comparison with the sum rule, he could decide which sources were doing a proper job and which ones didn't. So this is the sum rule, and a very nice demonstration of what it can be used. Now let's take another case. Yes?
Sorry. I would expect this for maybe an aluminium or aluminum, whatever, gas. And if you have this metal, you get the whole band structure.
Well, you're right. So that's actually why you have this stuff here. So this extra step is because of that. And there's probably fine structure that is not really resolved over here. But crudely speaking, it still
works. Valence part, this is the part that's
affected by the band structure, which has more. So in this here, if there would not be bands, this would be just one peak. And this dip wouldn't be there. This peak wouldn't be there. But still, if you do the counting of the electrons, it works surprisingly well. I'm surprised by it too. On the other hand, I also know that if you go high enough, this sum rule is sacred. It's exact. So in the end, you have to end up at 13 electrons. So no matter how strange it may behave over here, in the end, it has to be. You have to make it up somewhere in the process of integration. And this actually shows you that it's not so complicated in the end, in practice. Now we take magnesium oxide, and now we look at a different aspect. We come back to the aspect of having nuclei and electrons in the system. And we look at the F-sum rule for the optical conductivity once more. You go from zero to infinity. And according to what I said before, you have the contribution from the magnesium nuclei. Yeah. What do I say here? Yeah, this number is wrong. This should be plus, in fact, this is zero. No, yeah, this is wrong. Ah, let's see. Okay, I'm not going to change it. So this would be the nuclear charge, which for magnesium is 12. 12 plus, and this would be for oxygen, which is 8 plus. Maybe you write it down. And then there's 20 electrons altogether for the to compensate the charge over here, and those have minus E. So these are the three contributions you've got, where you have to correct those numbers over there. Now, if you imagine that we are that it doesn't form a solid, and that actually those particles don't interact with each other, they only interact with the light, then you could think of it as electrons, magnesium nuclei, and oxygen nuclei. They are all indicated here with slightly different colors for the two types of nuclei, and the electrons, which are bigger, of course, they're green. Now, this is what the optical conductivity would roughly look like. You have, as the green line, the electron contribution. It would be a Drude peak. A Drude peak is just a narrow peak centered at zero frequency. You have a similar kind of peak for the nuclear contribution, but it would be much weaker. In fact, even this here is plotted, multiplied by a factor of 1800. Otherwise, you simply wouldn't be able to see it. So 1800 is, of course, the mass ratio of electrons over protons. And the total would be very close to the electron contribution. In any case, you have these two contributions in there. And it would look like that. It would be two independent plasmas of electrons and nuclei. However, what we really have, of course, is that these electrons and those nuclei bind together. They form clusters. And so you would actually, what you form are Mg2 plus ions and O2 minus ions. So there are all in all, let's do the 10 electrons that bind to the nucleus of the oxygen, and also 10 to the magnesium. And so, in fact, I see a miscolored them because it would have been logical to make the oxygen blue and big and the magnesium red and small. And again, despite all the time and effort I put in preparing this, there are still screw-ups. This is one. Okay, I didn't draw it as a solid because it doesn't have to be a solid. You can take it to a high temperature and it can be a vapor or it can be a liquid, but it's important, or it can be a solid. Important is you have the oxygen and the magnesium ions in there. Now, if you actually measure the optical conductivity, you get something which looks like this. You have the energy as a log scale here, from 10 millielectron volt up to 10 electron volt. Around 10 electron volt, just a bit below, you have the onset of the electronic contribution. So this green line, which initially was this Drude peak, is shifted all over here. Here, you have the vibrations of magnesium against oxygen. Those are vibrational things now, and there's very little spectral weight in here. So this is what you get in reality. So if you put that together here, this is would be the high temperature phase where you form a plasma, high enough temperature where you form a plasma, you have to go to millions of degrees to do it, but where all these electrons are stripped from the nuclei. So there would be just the Drude peak over here. But at lower temperatures, smaller than 10 to the 4 centigrades, about 10,000 centigrades, this is what you actually get. Interband transitions over here and this vibrational peak over there. So here the current is actually carried by Mg2 plus and O2 minus ions, these clusters, and actually not carried by the individual particles. And of course, I made a big detour to get here. This is what you do in the first place, without any thinking even. This is what we normally always would do. It would be just ridiculous to think about the individual particles. I went through the effort of showing you that actually if you would start thinking about individual particles, the starting point is completely off from reality. So normally we bypass that and actually, always actually work with these composite particles. This is an obvious and a very trivial example of composite particles that you are already used to. So you haven't learned anything new here, except then that this concept may be useful, perhaps, in other things also, which we are maybe less used to. So for frequencies smaller than this gap of 8 electron volt, the degrees of freedom are ionic or vibrational, and the low energy current operator is the magnesium 2 plus plus the oxygen 2 minus current operator. And now we have actually a limited range sum rule, which only refers to those ions. So if you only look at the low frequency part, you go only up to this gap energy, or you stay below this gap energy of 10 electron volt, then this integral would only involve this part and that part, but now of the ions. So the mass of the magnesium ion, of the oxygen ion, and the charge, which indeed is now, it is 2 plus and 2 minus in this equation. This is what you would find. And since these masses are very big, this intensity, of course, is very small, thousands of times smaller than from the electronic contribution. Now you see that actually these charge terms are the same. The densities for magnesium and oxygen are the same. Only the masses are different. And actually this here is the reduced mass of the relative motion of magnesium against oxygen. So this limited range sum rule tells you that it's given, it depends on this, effective mass for the relative motion. Well, you can invert that too, just as we did for the electron. So we can, in this formula, we can actually move this mass factor to the left and only look at the density here. And we get a formula which says, OK, the density is 2 times this reduced mass times the volume of a unit cell divided by the charge, 2e squared and a pi, integrate this thing. And we look actually how this builds up. And if you do that, and these are data, we, you know, you see that actually this formula tells you that the N effective, where N is the number of N magnesium or oxygen ions or magnesium oxygen molecules, is indeed 1 per unit cell. Per unit cell is what we need to see. 1 per unit cell if you just use the experimental data. There's a little bit missing over here, but very close. So there's actually indeed the proper way of thinking about this is clearly in terms of composite particles. Okay, this was just for starters. So let's move to something a little bit more exciting and a little bit more unusual. Optical spectroscopy of insulators. We'll start with very usual stuff nonetheless. So we begin with strontium titanate. Strontium titanate has been used, is sometimes used, to make fake gemstones because it really looks like a beautiful kind of, it's not so difficult to make this stuff, even as a synthetic material, is not so difficult. You can dope it, and it gets a nice dark bluish kind of color. And so this is a material which has a so-called perovskite structure. So do we have? We have titanium ions, which are in a cage of 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 oxygen atoms around it, an octahedron of oxygen atoms around it. And then in between these cages, you have the strontium ions. Yeah? This is a perovskite three-dimensional structure. Now, there are many interesting properties of strontium titanate, and that's actually in part 3 of my lecture, but I will skip those. I will forgo that for now. And actually start with the band structure. Well, you just had dinner, and maybe you don't want to see spaghetti anymore. You can't even look at spaghetti anymore. But this is a so-called, we call that a spaghetti plot. So these are the bands, the occupied bands here, the empty bands, and they're split by an energy in this calculation of 2 electron volts. It's actually wrong because the actual gap is 3 electron volt. This is a known problem, not only for strontium titanate, that gaps are notoriously difficult to calculate. They're always usually a bit too small. So we just have to live with that. But in any case, that's what the band structure looks like. Now, you can make optical excitations by exciting electrons from these occupied states to the empty states, and by doing so, you form an electron here and a hole there, an electron-hole pair. In the optical spectrum, which for this compound was most properly and very, very well measured already in 1968 by Manuel Cardona, you see that the optical conductivity, this is after Cardona because he didn't actually show in this paper the optical conductivity, but other things like N and kappa. So I spend half an hour recalculating it and replotting. It looks a little bit wiggly, and that's because of my what I did, not because of what Cardona did. So it starts at around 3 electron volt. That's the actual gap. It goes up, and maxima, and so there are all kinds of interband transitions between these states. But the first onset is precisely this point over here. That's the first energy to create an electron-hole pair in this optical spectrum.
What does this zero mean? Where?
This is the zero of energy. This is the zero of photon energy.
Yeah.
Oh, the zero is a hole.
Yeah, but this is in the... There.
Here, this here?
In the band structure, or it has nothing to do with it.
Oh. It's the Fermi, yeah, the Fermi energy can be anywhere in between here, actually. You can put it anywhere you like. Yeah, it has to be between somewhere in the gap. Yeah, but actually, this material, the reason maybe why they do it this way, I don't know. If you dope it, it's very difficult to make whole doped strontium titanate. There's only one group who ever claimed they could do it. So naturally, the Fermi energy, with just a little bit of doping or impurities, would naturally fall right there, actually. Maybe it's for that reason, I don't know. But in principle, for an insulator, the Fermi energy is in the gap, right?
Yeah.
Now, so this is the first example. Okay, so so far so good. Nothing special, actually. Nothing to be excited about. Huh? Boring. Okay, potassium chloride. I wanted to take sodium chloride, but again, since you already had dinner and you had more than enough sodium chloride, you take the other one, potassium chloride. It's almost the same, really. This is what it looks like. Nice. Big, colorless crystals. Colorless, it means that actually the optical gap is bigger than what the eye can see. And so the band gap in this case, in this material, sits at more than 8.5 electron volt over here. This is actually where the absorption begins. This here sits over here. This is a measurement, but I call it a little bit to make it more clear what you see, and also to cover something that I want to show now. So the excitations that in this band are either from here to there, that's the lowest you can have, or from there to there, and you're already higher up, or from there to there. It's always vertical in an optical experiment, and that's because the photon doesn't transfer very much momentum, almost zero on the scale. So these are always vertical transitions. Here plotted is the collective momentum. I need it because I want to talk to you about what is the momentum of the electron hole pair. That's already in the spirit of talking about combined objects, clusters. So this cluster here doesn't carry any momentum because you have taken just as much momentum, the momentum that you add to this particle was taken away there. So together, the momentum of those two together, the electron hole pair, is zero. So this one has this energy corresponding to this distance here with zero momentum. That one also has zero momentum, but a smaller energy. And this one has zero momentum, this is an intermediate energy. So you actually have a continuum of states with zero momentum. But you can also look at transitions where you make a hole here and an electron there. And then actually it has final momentum. And that actually traces this lower bound of this parabola. This parabola is actually the lower bound of the momentum that electron hole pairs can have. So it's a parabola. Okay. Now, if you do an optical excitation across the gap, electron-hole excitation, it's always vertical, as said here, as shown here. The electron and the hole are assumed not to interact with each other. So, thing that I made, so you see they move without, in fact, affecting each other. Just go straight. That's what we have drawn over here. Okay. Or it can be a little bit farther away in the Brillouin zone. They still move without influencing each other. They just have more energy together. Now we are at zero momentum and over there. However, if we actually look at the spectrum, not only we had these interband transitions there, but we have all this stuff over here, for which we know that it is not interband transitions. They shouldn't be there, but they are there. And these are excitons. Some of you have heard about it. Maybe all of you have heard about it. Not all of you probably know what they are. Who knows what an exciton is? And soon you will all know what an exciton is. Isn't that great? Yeah. So already you see it here. This is an exciton. And it is just there in potassium chloride, you know, or it's also there in sodium chloride, just as mundane as that. And actually, it sits at an energy of this one. It is one electron volt lower than the gap. OK, what is that? So in this plot, we have now states over here. Yeah. Which we didn't expect on the basis of the electronic structure when we drew the bands. On the basis of these bands here, you cannot have this. There's no distance between those bands actually smaller than this. So what is it? It can't be there. And still they are there, and it's actually quite strong in the spectrum and sharp. Well, this is the formal equation for it. These are Feynman diagrams. They show, they say, okay, you have a photon coming in, it creates an electron hole pair, just as we showed, and then, we only have to think about half of it. And what happens later doesn't matter. Or you can have an electron hole pair created, but now the electron and the hole interact with each other. That's what this dotted line means. Or they can make the interaction twice or more. And if you add it all up, you get something like here. There's a photon coming in. It makes an electron hole pair, but the electron and the hole actually interact with each other. And this series of diagrams is also known as the beta-Salpeter equation for excitons. Okay, now if that happens, then actually the exciton that forms is actually a bound pair of an electron hole. Why does that happen? Well, there's interaction between them. They will, and I'll give you the more precise, but in any case, the electron and the hole can actually form a sort of an atom, like a hydrogen atom. It's like a proton and an electron, because the hole and the electron also attract each other. This is something which wasn't there when we did the calculation based on the band structure. We simply forgot about it. But if you make these electron hole pairs and you allow them to get close enough to each other, they can form bound states. And that's what it means. And bound states are actually a little bit spread. So for each electron and a hole separately, the momentum is not so precisely defined anymore. But together, they have a very sharply defined momentum over here, and also a very sharply defined excitation energy from zero to here. Or this difference from the band gap to the exciton, we call that the exciton binding energy. That tells us how much energy you win by binding the electron hole pairs over here to form an exciton. Now, the model for that, and we take the simplest one, is the model where you say, okay, we have a free electron, a free hole, and the Coulomb interaction can be screened. But that's what we have. Then the Hamiltonian has the kinetic energy of the collective motion of the electron hole and the hole together, where the hole and electron move together. It's the center of mass motion. Or you have the relative motion, which involves this relative mass, this reduced mass, 1 over mu, which is m, which is 1 over m plus 1 over mh. And then there's the interaction term between the electron and the hole. It's just a Coulomb force between an electron and a hole, but it's attractive because one is positive and the other is negative, just like in hydrogen. Now, since this is in a solid, there is still the screening by all the core electrons or whatever you have, and so there's an epsilon in this formula as well, which you wouldn't have in vacuum, but you have it in solids. Okay, so let's just do some estimation, a very quick one. So if we know that we have this Hamiltonian, and we already know what the solutions are, because we have all followed our quantum physics courses, and you know we've then gone through the Legendre and the whatever, all those Laguerre polynomials and so. So we know that we have all these hydrogenic solutions of that thing. And so in the end, that's very simple. Namely, you have either continuum states above the gap, which is the gap energy plus the center of mass momentum squared over the center of mass, and then the relative momentum squared divided by the relative mass. And then we have also bound states. So there's the same prefactor here, but then there is, or the first term is the same, but rather than having these positive continuum states of electron hole pairs, we also have bound states because of this term over here and because it looks like hydrogen. And these bound states are just given by Rydberg divided by n squared. Except then, of course, the Rydberg involves, just like in the hydrogen atom, is almost the same thing, except the Rydberg for hydrogen also. That's the mass of the reduced mass of electron and proton together times electron charge to the power 4 over 2 h bar squared. And since we have e to the power 4, here we have to divide by the dielectric constant squared. Vacuum, that's just 1. And this would be the free electron mass if it were hydrogen. The optical conductivity will have two terms. The terms that come from the bound states over here. So you start to absorb when the energy corresponds to the gap energy minus Rydberg over n squared. And then we have the continuum states, and that's when the energy corresponds to the gap plus h bar k squared over 2 mu In this case, we don't have to deal with this first fact because the center of mass, there is no center of mass transferred by, when the momentum transferred by a photon is so small that we may say, okay, this is almost zero. Okay, that's what the formula looks like. And here are some crude estimates. So Rydberg, I suppose you all know, is 13.6 electron volt. But now the masses are not always the same. So let's start with positronium. Positronium is the simplest case of an exciton. You just take vacuum, you put an electron in there, and you put an anti-electron in there, and you let them interact with each other. And that gives you half a Rydberg of binding energy. Half a Rydberg because it's the reduced mass is now a reduced mass of a positron and an electron, and not of a proton and an electron. You take potassium chloride, well, the masses are about the same for the electron in a hole, is about 1. Epsilon is about 5 in this case, and so the Rydberg would be about 300 millielectron volt. Yeah? Or you take strontium titanate, now it depends. I mean, those masses are still of the order 1. I'm not very precise about it. In fact, the dielectric screening is either 5 if you take the high frequency screening, or it is 10,000 if you take the low frequency screening. And the question is, which one should you actually take here? So I don't want to choose here, but if you take the high frequency screening, you have 300 millielectron volt binding energy, and otherwise you have a tenth of a microelectron volt binding energy. Now apparently in strontium titanate you more have to do with this, because there is no exciton. I showed you the spectra of that compound, and there was no exciton. There was an exciton over here. Copper 2O, cuprous oxide, I'm going to show you that too. Again, those masses about 1. Epsilon is about 7, you get about 100 millielectron volt for your exciton binding energies. There will be more about excitons, but if you have some question, some conceptual question about it now. Yeah?
You always call the bands which were starting as an interband transition. Why is it not an why don't we have an intraband transition, or is it there?
Would it exist for intraband transitions?
Yeah.
Yeah, there are things like that.
Is it possible in such an insulating material to have an intraband transition?
In a metal, so excitons in the metal would not really exist as sharply defined particles, because their energy would overlap with free electron hole pairs between the bands, and for that reason they don't live very long. But as a resonance, that does exist actually also, even in a metal. Yeah. There are cases like that. No. But I wanted to start simple here. Yeah. And in fact, I won't go much farther than that simple actually also. Now, you also have exciton flavors, and that has to do, yeah?
So, eventually the sharp peak, there could also be something like a phase defect or...
Oh yeah, sure, you have that too. Yeah, yeah. You have that too.
Why is it like?
Well, in this case, there was no defect. They made sure there were none. But if you put in impurities, you may get stuff that looks very similar. However, on the other hand, so you can have donor states, which are just below. But these are neutral bands. These are neutral states. So they're there. So they're not occupied by anything. And so how do we know, how do you establish that you have to do with an exciton and not with... Well, you have to do a whole lot of... Well, first of all, you can, of course, compare to theory. What has theory to say about it? If it actually corresponds and this is the data, then you know you have an exciton. Then it is actually possible to make potassium chloride really very clean also.
Yeah. And the same question, like, similar to what she was saying, like, can you also, like, if it's hydrogen states, can you also have B exciton?
Yes. Let me continue about that. I was coming to that. And that is actually one of the... if you see all that, then, of course, you can be quite sure that it is not impurity states. And I'll show you an example of that. Yeah. So I was about to say that here. So if you look at this Rydberg, of course, then you expect 0.1 below this gap. So I've shown only 3, but in principle there's an infinite series, and then Rydberg series about, below that. And so they come in flavors also, because they have their internal quantum numbers, not only the main quantum number, there are also orbital and even spin quantum numbers associated to excitons. So here we have now shown the example of an exciton, which is not the lowest branch, but the higher branch over here. And so each. So let's give one further example, a relatively simple one. Copper 2 oxygen. This is actually a compound that is no longer a candidate material for solar cells, but it was, let's say, 40 years ago. This has been abandoned, apparently. It didn't look very promising at the time. These things can come back, by the way. But silicon typically, clearly, is the one that has won the game for the time being. It's a beautiful red-colored material. It has to do with the size of the gap, not with the exciton itself, in this case. And actually, here we have part of the optical data published by Uline. This is actually done with two-photon absorption. They also did single-photon absorption. In the two-photon absorption, you have slightly different rules, excitation rules, and you see different states. So the optical band gap is at 2.17 eV, begins over here. It's not in the two-photon, you don't see it very clearly. Single-photon, you see it clearly going up over there. Then you see a whole series of states below them, and each of those you can identify as the 1S state, as the 2S state, as S and as D transitions. The P's you don't see because of selection rules. You would see them in the single photon absorption, but not in the two photon absorption. And so all of those can actually be identified by the appropriate quantum numbers. It's not exactly a Rydberg series because actually the bands that we're talking about are not perfectly parabolic bands. And so there is more going on. There are also crystal fields around that actually change a little bit the orbital structure in this compound. But it is very close to that. And so this one is very well established, these excitons. The binding energy is about, in this case, 0.14 electron volt. And when I made my quick estimate, I said 0.1 electron volt. So it's not so bad, actually. Yes? This is the two-photon absorption. So it's done, this is a somewhat unusual optical technique. Yeah. They also showed single-photon absorption, which is called optical conductivity, and you have less peaks, and it starts somewhere over here, with peaks in between because it sees the other quantum numbers. Okay, so this is about the simple kind of excitons in simple compounds. Now we move to excitons of a more even extreme kind. Extreme excitons, extremons. That's collective modes in mod insulator. Now, we first have to tell what a mod insulator is. Who does not know what a mod insulator is? Okay, so I have to go through that. Fine. So it's shown over here. But we start with metal. You all know what a metal is, of course. Metal is you just take a box and put electrons in it, and you let them occupy states up to the Fermi energy by using the Pauli principle, and it forms some kind of a fluid kind of state, and I've tried to make a picture of it. There's a bit of structure in this fluid kind of state because if you have a crystal, then of course the atoms form a regular lattice, but nonetheless the electron states spill out over to the neighbors and they don't fill all the states, and because not all the states are filled, it is possible to support the current. It requires now that H over tau is bigger than U. Now what is U and what's tau? H over tau. Tau is actually the time it takes to hop from here to there, to tunnel from here to there. And if this tunneling probability is very, very high, extremely high, then the kinetic energy of the electrons will be very high. And this actually says if the kinetic energy in the bands is just bigger than the interaction energy, then you will easily form a metal. If, on the other hand, that's not the case, let's say we have sort of separate atoms or almost separate atoms, that's different. So imagine. This is always the best way to understand it intuitively. Imagine that we take hydrogen atoms. Unfortunately, what I'm going to give as an example cannot be realized in experiment. But it can sort of do. So imagine you take hydrogen atoms. Each hydrogen atom has one electron on it. And we put these hydrogen atoms really closely together to form a solid, like over there. Yeah? Then we would have one electron on the average per atom, would that be a metal or an insulator? Who says it would be a metal? Good, that's the right answer. Because this means you have half filled your band, the Fermi energy is just sitting in the middle of the band structure, and it will be a metal. Find the density of states of the Fermi energy. That must be a metal. So if you have an odd number of electrons per unit cell, then you form a metal. Standard rule of solid-state physics. However, let's not do it. Let's actually do it a little bit different. We actually take a hydrogen atom, we just pull them above, away from each other, and we put 1 meter between every hydrogen atom. Would that be a metal? No, because each electron will be just tied to the atom, and it wouldn't conduct at all. So intuitively, it wouldn't be a metal. But now we let these atoms approach each other, yeah, and now they start to touch, like indicated over here. Yeah. And at some point, you say, OK, now I'm not so sure anymore. You know, what's actually the criterion for a metal or not? And this is what Mott actually cooked up, Mott and Hubbard together. Said, OK, now we have to compare two energy scales. Suppose that the h bar over the hopping time, which is the tunneling energy from here to there, would still be very small compared to the energy it takes to pile two electrons on the same atom. That's what the U represents. That's the repulsive energy to put two electrons on the same. Then actually, this wouldn't want to conduct, because this is actually what happened. I can repeat it a couple of times, like this. You know, the electron tries to move to the neighbor, but then, it moves up the potential hill. It, when sitting there, the energy is U higher. That's the interaction energy than it was before. And actually, it doesn't want to stay there because it finds a more comfortable position over there. Of course, that picture only works as long as they can't zap around fast enough, as they did over here. So if this term becomes dominant and much bigger than the U, then they will zap around. They will actually form, first of all, their completely delocalized Bloch waves, which then put together, and they will be influenced a little bit by the U, but not enough to make it an insulator. But this is still an insulator. So every atom has just one electron on it. And that's the Mott insulating state. And as you can imagine, there's a whole field of physics that tries to describe the metal insulator in this very simple model, the insulator to metal transition. Very difficult problem to solve exactly. Now, these systems do exist. So here we have copper germanium O3. The germanium really doesn't matter, and neither does the oxygen. You essentially have chains of copper atoms. And these copper atoms have one hole in it. And holes are just like electrons. So 990 electrons in the D shell, or one hole in the D shell, behaves in the same way. They're occupying one hole over here. Now, if you calculate the density of states just using a band structure calculation, you will find that there is some density of states on the oxygen atoms and on the copper atoms. The copper atom density of states will be strongly centered around the Fermi energy. There's a set of bands over here and a second set of bands over here. And the Fermi energy will actually fall right in the second band. It will be a metal because we have one hole sitting in this band. So one electron here and one hole there in this band, which is the DXY, the DXZ band. All the other ones are full. So it would be a metal, except then, of course, we just learned about this Mott principle. And in fact, if you switch on in your calculation the on-site Coulomb interaction, you redo the calculation. There's some approximation involved, but what you get is now the Fermi energy sits somewhere over here. So this band here splits in two, one here and one there, and the Fermi energy sits in between. So now it is an insulator with a gap, and the gap is about 2 electron volt over here. It's not this U because there's all the other bands that influence. It's about 2 electron volt gap. So this is what we should use. That corresponds to reality.
Are those measurements?
These are calculations using relatively reasonable approximations. It's not exact now. There's no exact calculation for this. Now, so let's see what we get if we do an experiment, just an optical experiment on this. So first of all, we have the charge transfer excitations. What happens is a photon comes in. It actually kicks the hole from here to its neighbor, or let's say an electron goes from here. It leaves behind an empty, so this is a full shell now, and this one has now 2 electrons in it. Yeah? So this becomes a bit bigger. Sorry, it has 2 holes in it, but still it becomes a bit bigger. And that actually gives rise to this absorption edge. This is not the optical conductivity, but something related to the absorption coefficient. So there's actually an edge over here at about, 3 electron volt. So it's about 3 electron volt gap. This is one kind of excitation. However, now we have a very special kind of exciton that's possible. That's the next graph. Photon comes in, and rather than actually kicking the electron from there to there, we just rotate this thing to a different state. We make an orbital excitation. So this is also, if you wish, an electron hole pair, because we removed a hole over here, and we put the hole now in a state that is oriented like this. So it is an electron hole pair, but the electron hole pair sits on the same atom. So they are as close as they can be without being exactly in the same orbital. And so the binding is huge. So this one actually sits down there at around sort of in the middle of the gap. And actually this absorption peak makes that you have this beautiful purple color. Without this absorption peak, it would be just white. But now it has this fantastic, beautiful color. And that's because of the exciton. See how important the excitons and how real they are. You see them, actually, with your own eyes. Another very famous example is nickel oxide. Nickel oxide is this green stuff. If you do, now here's an experiment which actually measures the density of states below the Fermi energy and above the Fermi energy, photoemission and inverse photoemission. In the break-in can tell you about inverse photoemission. It's not so very well known anymore. There's a gap of 4.3 electron volt here. This is the Hubbert gap again, for the same reasons as for the copper germanate. Nickel oxide also has a Hubbert gap interaction effect. This is what the optical absorption looks like on a log scale, but this is roughly what would be the optical conductivity. Here you have this 4 electron volt charge transfer energy that's to go from there to there, but then you have all this stuff. It starts, well, these are phonons, but you have this peak, that peak, that peak, that peak. So what is all this stuff? There are transitions where just you rotate the orbital. So these are very, very deep excitons. This is as deeply bound as you can possibly imagine. And these are not impurity. So, excitons, why do we care? Is it just a game? In fact, I did some internet browsing to find this one. Apparently it's a game called Evil Swarm Exciton Knight. Whatever it's worth, looks like this. You see, it has something to do with seeing things differently. So there's some relation to optics here. That's all I can say about it. No, because excitons actually do play an important role in photovoltaic devices. Whether that role is for the good or for the bad, it almost sounds like Tolkien here, future will show. But they do play a role, and a very important role, actually. So it actually means that the first excitation you get is an exciton. This will break apart at some point. But that's the exciton. Very important. Actually, the excitons demonstrate that interactions matter, and that they matter a lot. Even in kitchen salt, they live deep inside the electron hole gap. They actually carry most of the spectral weight in your optical spectrum sits in those excitons and not in the interband transition. If you do a band circuit calculation, you're actually blind for excitons. So clearly, we need a deeper, or at least some, it's extra, it's different. And it's really different from what you expect. So it just shows you that something sucks about band theory. Okay. So that's the summary of part one. I think I went too fast, right, because I was supposed to finish. Oh, no, it's only part one. I still have to do part two. I go too slow. Well, that's fine. It doesn't matter. Okay. We have talked about this Epsom rule. The optical conductivity counts each electron and even each nuclear particle. The electromagnetic field sees composite particles like ions and phonons. There was a bit more, but it's fell off the screen. Excitons are bound electron hole pairs with zero charge. And we've talked about two cases, normal insulators, and there they're sort of electron hole orbitals, somewhat extended. And the binding energy is typically much smaller than the energy of the gap itself. They dangle just below the gap. If you have Mott-Hubbert insulators, then the electron hole pair is confined to an atomic site, and so the binding energy can be as big as the Mott gap itself. Not bigger, because then you would have a different ground state. I think that's all I had to say about part one. Time to wrap up some questions and then move to part two. Because I think our break is only 10 minutes, right? So I can make a start with part two and continue after the break. Any questions about this?
Do we need to know this orbital excitations? I don't have an intuitive picture for that. So what? Because the orbitals are defined by the crystal structure. So what is the rotation of those available
states? Yeah, I did it in a classical way. That may not always be very helpful. So I'll try to illustrate it here. This is always I'll do it for a P-wave orbital. It's easier than a D-wave orbital.
Yeah.
So P waves, and we do it in this screen here. This is the PX, yeah? And I'll do in blue the PY. Yeah? Okay, now imagine that we are in the ground state. In the ground state, we would have, so we need two of those. Okay. Now, the ground state would have the electron over here. Yeah. The excited state, the one where you have an exciton, would have it over here. Now, if I draw just like this, those energies would be the same. But you should imagine that there is some crystal field that makes the that splits the degeneracy between Px and Py. And then that's what it is. So it is really an electron hole pair where you remove the electron here and put it over there. Okay. We have fully saturated the subject. Let's move on to part two. I imagine there are four, but maybe that's too much. Okay, so we're going to talk about superconductors and about interactions in superconductors. So we go back to 1911, to our friend Heike Kamerling-Onnes, who, with his collaborators, Philip Holst and others, measured the resistivity of mercury, solid mercury, at that temperature, very clear, very clean mercury. They cooled it down, and resistivity went down, and then bang, it dropped, and they were just around 4.2 Kelvin, it dropped to a real zero. They had to redo the experiment several times just to make sure that this was not just some screw up in the experiment, and in the end they were sure it was not a screw up. It was a real zero resistance state. That was the beginning of the subject of superconductivity. They called it supraconductivity. The first paper, one of the first papers in the same year, was for the Solvay Congress in Belgium, and it's actually in the proceedings of the Solvay, the first Solvay Congress. It's a very thick book. And everybody at the Solvay Congress, Einstein and Bohr and de Broglie, they were all debating about black body radiation and about the Planck law and sort of beginning to understand that there was something more than classical physics. And there was Heike Kamerling-Onnes who said, "And I observed supraconductivity." And nobody cared shit. There was no response at all to that, no question, nothing. Yet it is the most biggest, let's say, scale quantum phenomena that we know today. You can see it on kilometers length scale, and it's quite impressive, actually. Now, it took a long time until 1955, I think it was, that Bardeen, Cooper, and Schriever actually came as a full explanation of superconductivity. They said, okay, if electrons attract each other, let's say, they attack each other already, but let's assume that we are at some high temperature, that because of thermal fluctuation, they are still driven apart. But now, if you cool it down at some point, they can overcome the thermal fluctuations and form pairs. Now, of course, why would they attract? That's a long story, and there are many debates about it. And but this is just saying, okay, if you have electrons coupling each of them separately to a matrix, yeah, and a matrix you could think of, let's say, the elastic deformation of your medium around the electrons. Now, to make this more understandable to you, I actually drew this picture of two electrons lying on a mattress. I'm not sure if you ever did this, but when I was a student, I did. Could you switch off the camera, please, because it's too... Okay. No, I'm just kidding. So in our student years, we would take our girlfriends to vacation. In Paris, for example, we would not be able to afford more expensive hotels, so we would take hotels in the neighborhood of Place d'Italie. They were cheap, and the beds were very soft. And now they made this remarkable observation that if you put two people on a very soft mattress, they always fall into the same hole. You may know that in experience, and if you haven't, try. It's really worthwhile. And so there is actually a completely scientific explanation for it, even. It doesn't involve any kind of psychology. So actually, if you calculate the deformation energy here and there, it's the weight of this body squared times the spring constant times half, that one, 2. It gives precisely the weight, a factor of 2 for that thing. Here, you have to take the two masses together and then square times the spring constant. That gives a factor of 4. So actually, the deformation, the energy you gain in this situation is twice as big as over there because you share the same hole. So it is a physical process. And so the idea is that this also happens if you put electrons in a material where they interact with the phonons, and somehow, by sharing the same phonons, they can actually roll together, despite the fact that they also have a Coulomb repulsion. This can actually overcome the Coulomb repulsion if you put everything together. So they form Cooper pairs when the temperature is low enough. The center of mass momentum of these Cooper pairs is capital K, but actually is zero unless there's a current, because then they all move with the same center of mass motion. If these things form, they actually condense immediately in a Bose-Einstein condensate. There's a very good reason for it. And so this is the center of mass coordinate in one plane only, so kx and ky. This is the number of particles. This is not for Cooper pairs, by the way. This is for cold atoms. There are no such pictures for Cooper pairs. But they all occupy the same state. There's a certain which has to do with the resolution of the experiment. So in principle, there's a delta function sitting over here, where all pairs present share the same center of mass momentum. Or if there's a current, they all flow with exactly the same velocity. It's a quantum phenomenon which you can see from different things. For example, the magnetic flux penetrates in a superconductor in integer multiples of h over 2e. This is one such h over 2. We call it the vortex. There's another one. There's another. Actually, these things interact with each other. So these are just magnetic flux tubes. And the interaction makes that they form lattices, often called abricots of lattice, because abricots have predicted it. So these are fantastic experiments done with STM in this case, which actually demonstrate that you have this quantum phenomenon, not only of superconductivity, but even of related and derived things like vortices. Now, since the electrons share their hole in the matrix, they're bound together, like in an exciton, and there's a certain binding energy that need to overcome to separate them, and this is called the gap. So there's actually a gap in a superconductor. This here is the density of states for the occupied and the unoccupied states, and rather than being just flat around the Fermi energy, there's actually a gap in there, spectacularly seen in these tunneling spectra. This is on a scale of 10 millielectron volt. This is the superconducting gap, so a very small gap. In an insulator, you talk about gaps of 1, 2, 10 electron volt. This is 1, 2, 10 millielectron volt. Three orders of magnitude smaller than the other kind of gaps. If you do optical spectroscopy, you actually see that also. There is, if you go to low enough temperature, this is a different compound, you see a gap, you're 5 millielectron volt. This is the theory, that's the experiment. This is not at zero temperature. At zero temperature, there would be no gap. And it would be actually a delta function at zero frequency, but delta functions are so difficult to measure. But there's a delta function that has to do with the Cooper pairs. So I'll stop after this slide. So the excitations energy, when they are bigger than 2 delta, this spectrum tells you that you start to see density of states for individual electrons on the occupied state, unoccupied side, or Hall excitations, individual halls on the unoccupied side, if the energy is bigger than 2 delta. If it's smaller, then you don't have these states here. In the optical spectrum, you also have to go to 2 delta before you see anything at all. And there's actually peak over here. There's a delta function peak. But these are collective excitations. And now you may say, OK, well, the supercurrent is carried by those pairs, not by individual electrons. So might there be collective excitation somewhere down there, like excitons in the insulator? And this, ladies and gentlemen, question will be answered in the next talk. Fortunately, after the break, you only have to be patient for 15 minutes for that. That's it for then. So we have admired the gap seen either in the single particle density of states in the left, or the gap seen in the combined electron hole density of states, as you see in optics on the right. And the question is, would there be collective degrees of freedom that might show up below the gap, just in the same way as we saw for excitons below the gap in an insulator, or for phonons below the gap in an insulator? These are not insulators, but could it be different or similar? And the answer to that was actually given by P. W. Anderson already in 1958. I'll say a bit more to the motivation of this behind the at the end. One of the motivations, now the most important one, was that he wanted to show that superconductors are superconductors, because the BCS theory, which had appeared years before, described everything except the current carrying state. It was all about the state where there was no supercurrent yet. And so he made the theory gauge invariant, which allowed to describe the Meissner effect and the superconducting phase. And he did it because he was just thinking about this problem. If we have this condensate of Cooper pairs, and we imagine that these Cooper pairs, this condensate would move, we have to think about also other possibilities, maybe including waves that can oscillate inside the condensate of these Cooper pairs. And maybe these are excitations that would show up somehow in the spectrum and could even be measured. What it ultimately led to is what is nowadays known as the Anderson-Hicks mechanism. Now, he said the following thing. Suppose that we have a material that goes superconducting, but let's assume for the moment that it is a, he didn't use these words, but that was implicit. Let's assume that it is a bad metal where in the normal state there is not yet a plasmon present. Normally you have already a plasmon. Does anybody not know what a plasmon is, by the way? Okay, in a few words, if you have a metal and you shake the liquid of electrons uniformly, just take the entire block of electrons in the metal, you slosh it from one side to the other side of the metal, you can, it will actually start in an oscillation at a certain frequency, and that frequency is the plasma frequency. Now, it's a high frequency by virtue of the fact that these things have a long-range Coulomb interaction, which pushes this frequency to, in aluminum, to about 15 electron volt. But if you have a bad metal, you can actually quench that plasma frequency by disorder. You can just damp it out entirely. And so there would be no plasmon in a normal state. The plasma frequency would be zero or overdamped. If that's the case, he said, and I'll illustrate it with plots later on, then we have not the usual screening. And here you should imagine what a plasmon actually means for a metal. A metal becomes a mirror for all optical frequencies smaller than the plasma frequency. Why is that? Well, for frequencies smaller than the plasma frequency, there is no light possible inside the matter. No light. There are no solutions to the Maxwell equations of transverse polarized electromagnetic waves, or light, below the plasma frequency. Now, if you push the plasma frequency to zero somehow by making the metal very bad, then that prohibition doesn't exist anymore, and you do have light inside the metal for all frequencies. So there will be a relation between frequency and momentum, which is P times V. Now, V in vacuum would be the light velocity. In a metal, it's not, because there's always some screening, as I said before, some dielectric constant or whatever, and so it will be typically smaller. But he said, if the material becomes superconducting, then there must always be a plasmon. And he showed how that works, and that's a work of many interesting, and it's a very tedious calculation actually using random phase approximation. But he said the plasma frequency is there because there's a superfluid which is not damped, which is necessarily not damped. That's why it is a superfluid. And in that case, there will be a plasmon associated to that. And so the frequency of this plasmon will be proportional to the square root of the superfluid density. Now, there will be transverse electromagnetic waves. And of those, the frequency will be given by a formula that looks a little bit like special relativity, actually. So if you think of omega being the energy, it looked like the energy, which is kinetic energy square plus m square c to the 4, and then the square of the whole thing. That is actually the usual relation for a special relativity between energy and momentum. So this actually tells you that there is a gap, because if we take the momentum to be zero in the center of the Brillouin zone, where this term is zero, then there's still this transverse electromagnetic light still has a finite frequency. There are no frequencies lower than this omega PS, and if you go to some finite frequency, this disperses up a little bit. So there's actually a gap, and so it means that there's no light that can penetrate the superconductor below this superconducting plasma frequency, and so it becomes a perfect reflector below that. That's one of the consequences. Now, so this is actually what it looks like, this dispersion. So we have momentum over here, P over H, K if you like, this is the momentum. Here we have the plasma frequency in an example of a possible superconductor, not a particular one really. These would be the plasma frequency as a function of momentum, has very little dispersion typically. There might be a little bit, but here we just took it to be zero. So that's longitudinally polarized electromagnetic waves. And the light-like solution, transverse polarized light, actually is gapped from this frequency on and then becomes more like normal light at higher frequency. That was the theory prediction by Anderson. Now, this can be measured, but not so easy, because you have to define the right material. I mentioned the example of amorphous bismuth. Well, in that material, the experiment has never been done, but we did it actually in this material here. We took a high TC cuprate. And why do we do it? Because these materials are strongly anisotropic, and actually for the direction perpendicular to the conducting planes, they are like bad metals. If you measure the resistivity in this direction, then you find that the resistivity is not only very high, but also that if it goes superconducting, so there is actually no plasma frequency for this direction in a normal state. Although there is a plasma frequency for this direction, but not for this direction. So if these are the planes that go superconducting, there is still a weak coupling between them, and that's actually there's a Josephson coupling between those planes, so there is a bit of, which means there is a very weak, but an extremely weak supercurrent possible from one plane to the other. And that actually determines, in this case, the plasma frequency. So you may say that the superfluid density for motion in this direction is extremely small. Yeah, so that is going to be the plasma frequency I just mentioned. Okay, and this is what these cuprates look like. You have conducting planes, and then from one plane to the other, there's a weak coupling between them, sort of a tunneling coupling. Now, the quantity of interest that we now talk about is not going to be the optical conductivity or partially, but mostly we'll talk about a loss function. Loss function has a simple relation to the optical conductivity. I give it, in principle, an unusual definition of it. Normally, it would involve epsilon, but I wanted to keep the number of definitions to the absolute bare minimum here. We have now introduced one thing, sigma, and so you can define also a loss function in terms of sigma, and in terms of the optical conductivity is omega over 4 pi sigma of omega minus I omega, where sigma is complex, is a real and imaginary part. Okay, now if the optical conductivity of a superconductor would be, if there would be no dissipation at all, this would be entirely imaginary. It would be omega p squared over 4 pi omega times I. That's actually what it would be in a superconductor without damping.
The same loss function as this imaginary part of one
yeah. Yeah, for those who already know it, it's confusing, of course, but yeah, it is the same thing. Yeah. Now, in a superconductor, typically you will be having parallel not only the superflow, but there will be also some conductivity at finite frequencies, because there's always some absorption because of something, let's say phonons or some stray particles. And that gives rise to this second term here, gamma square. So it can be zero, but it is small, but it is always there. Actually, that translates in the, for the loss function in a term in the denominator. So the loss function here will look like omega p superconducting square minus omega square square. This is the resonant part. There is a small damping part to it, which also appears in the denominator. But and then the whole thing is multiplied with omega square. So this is actually a resonant formula, almost like a delta function. It becomes a delta function if you take gamma in the limit of zero. Now, this is for all temperatures, but let's start here at 33 Kelvin. Tc is 30 Kelvin. At 33 Kelvin, this is what the loss function looks like for currents and in fields perpendicular to the planes. There's no plasmon there in the normal state, or it would have to be a very low frequency. But now, this is above Tc. But now you warm it up. You cool it down. You cool it down through the phase transition, and you start to pick up this peak and shift to higher and higher frequencies. And this is here at 8 Kelvin. It sits at 6 millielectron volt. So now there is a resonance, there is a plasmon in the superconducting state. So this actually demonstrates one of these predictions of Anderson, that even if in the normal state there is no plasmon, if it goes superconducting, there must be a plasmon always. Of course, if you want to prove that it is always the case, you have to do the experiment on all superconductors, which we didn't. But this is at least a good example. Now, there's another thing which you can do that involves quite a bit of explanation, which I did not want to do here, although it is, you can ask me privately later about it. But it is actually possible also to do a either to calculate from the spectra or to measure directly the frequency versus momentum dispersion relation of the light inside the superconductor. There's a Fabry-Pirot resonance technique to do that. And so we have done that here, and this is the frequency versus momentum, and this is sort of, in a normal state, is almost linear. It actually starts to slope down a little bit here, so it's not as perfect, but in any case, there's no gap over here. It just comes down all the way to the origin. If you go in the superconducting state, this is what it looks like. There's a gap, and then it disperses up. So this looks very much like this graph that I showed three slides before, again the blue line, where light cannot enter for these frequencies, but it can enter from frequencies from the gap upwards, and then it starts dispersing up. So this is the coupling of this is due to the coupling of the order parameter and the actually of the phase of the order parameter and of the electromagnetic field, and that gives you a photon mass, in this case 6 millielectron volt, and this is actually the demonstration of the other term thing in the Anderson-Higgs mechanism. It's not about the Higgs particle itself. It's only about the mass generation in transverse and longitudinal polarized light inside the superconductor if there's coupling to the superconducting order. It has to be there. I give you another example of a peculiar mode that can appear. And that has to do with a very old model of Tony Leggett. It was predicted by him in 1966. He said, if we have a somewhat more complicated material, not even so complicated, he had in mind transition metals like niobium, where there are 3D bands and 4P bands, so at least two bands crossing the Fermi energy, and so that gives actually rise to two reservoirs, in principle, that are superconducting, each with their own phase and numbers. And he said, okay, if there's some coupling between those two reservoirs, between these two bands, which overlap in space, even if it's very weak, let's call it a Josen coupling, then actually if we move charge from one reservoir to the other, like in these buckets, there will be a restoring force that tries to push it back, and that restoring force is the Josen coupling energy. That's not true. There's the Josen coupling which drives it, but there's a restoring force which is due to the incompressibility of the electrons. So if you try to put more electrons in the same reservoir, you increase the density of it, and that means there is you compress it, and there's a restoring force proportional to the inverse of the compressibility, which is also, by the way, proportional to the density of states, the Fermi energy. And this is very technical now for most of you. If you put all these things together, then there is the coupling term, this is the storing force, and that gives you the collective amount that oscillates at the square root of the Joule's coupling energy divided by the density of states. And again, it will be a collective mode of some kind. It's not a plasmon. This is called a Leggett exciton, or a Leggett mode. Now, this was predicted in 66, and it was never seen until this, and also later on in magnesium diboride. This story started a little bit different, and actually started as follows. We had actually the possibility to make superconductors, cuprate superconductors, where you had a superconducting layer, an insulating layer, a superconducting layer, another kind of insulating layer. So there's Joule's coupling here. There's a different kind of Joule's coupling there. So there's Joule's coupling 1, Joule's coupling 2, 1 and 2 alternating. So it's a superlattice in a way with alternating Joule's couplings. The layers themselves are the same. Well, if you think of that problem, and you do the same thing as we already did for Leggett mode, you should also keep in mind that since these are planes, there's also a capacitive force between those planes. And that capacitive force is exactly the same thing as for the usual Joule's plasmon. It gives also a restoring force. It's just electrostatic coupling between charge in this plane to the next one if you make an imbalance in charge. So that should be added to this restoring force because of the incompressibility. Now, there are two types of resonance you can imagine here. Either where the currents all move in the same direction, so it's the in-phase resonance. And if you do that, then you get a normal kind of plasmon that we already spoke before, because there's nothing happening to the reservoirs. In fact, the amount of charge in the reservoirs just remains the same. You only build up charge at the boundaries of the sample. That gives the usual Joule's plasmon. But there's also the out-of-phase resonance. In that case, there's a current flowing here in this direction, and the next layer goes in that direction. And now this bucket is more filled than that one, and that one is more filled, and so on and so forth. And now that you are bringing an imbalance in the occupation of these reservoirs, now the incompressibility does become important, the extra term. And in fact, if you add it all up and you work out the equations, this is the equation you get for the dielectric function. It's related to the optical conductivity in some way. And this is what the optical conductivity looks like. There's a delta function peak at zero frequency, as you should always have in a superconductor. Then there's an additional peak, and this is this Leggett exciton over here. If you look at the loss function, there's a peak here and a peak there. So there are two plasmons, not a single plasmon. That was the prediction. And there's something called a dielectric function that shows that there should be some zero crossings. Now, this is an example. This is a publication of Dulich from my group when was it? In 2002, I think. It was at the same time measured by two other groups. It all appeared in the same issue of PRL, same kind of compounds, independent work. And actually there, indeed, you see this mode in the optical conductivity, if it's superconducting, and it disappears in the normal state. And in the normal state, there's no peak in the loss function, but in the superconducting state, you see two of those. And in fact, that was something that agreed completely with the model also of Leggett. In order to get these intensities right, we had to assume a density of states and incompressibility, which is exactly the incompressibility which is already known for this kind of material. So it fitted the description, so to speak. This actually summarizes this story, that as a function of momentum, now this is for plasmons that propagate along the cedar perpendicular to the planes, yeah, and where you have a longitudinal polarization of them. There are two of those, so they disperse very little. This is for the electromagnetic waves, which are now have their polarization in the C direction, but they actually propagate along the planes. And then again, it starts with the same splitting as these plasmons here at the zone boundary. And there's some avoided crossing. And then, so this is also precisely what you expect. But I should say what is measured is only these two points here and that one. So you have apparently, Leggett modes in two-band superconductors, again, there have been further confirmations in different kinds of superconductors, NGB2 is one of them. So if you have a spontaneous symmetry breaking, there are two gaps that are non-zero over here. It gives you, each of those gaps actually corresponds to a Higgs boson separately, and there's one Leggett exciton. And there will be two photon flavors in these superconductors. So the two photon flavors are this one and that one. So for each momentum, there are actually two kinds of photons, surprisingly. Now, because there are these two order parameters that are both breaking, which are present in the superconducting state. In the normal state, there will be just one of those. So this is sort of mind-boggling, and it seems to say that if there would be two kinds of Higgs bosons in nature and not one, then also there will be two kinds of, okay, in this case, W and Z phonons, and not just one, and only one of those so far have been observed, but it makes it a bit more rich. Now, this is sort of peculiar because there are people who think there might be two Higgs bosons, actually, and not one. And if that's true, there will be very peculiar consequences for the stuff that it actually couples to. So, the summary of part two, and after this we only do part three and not part four also. So there are several kinds of multiparticle excitations inside the superconducting gap. These are not single electron excitations. These are many body excitations, like the excitons in the superconductor, or maybe even more exciting. You have plasmons, you have Leggett excitons. There are actually things like Higgs particles or Higgs modes, polaritons, and many of those have been detected. There are a couple more that I didn't talk about, Bardas's Schriever excitons and others in certain kinds of superconductors. Some of these had, or continue to have, a deep implications for the basic fabric of the superconductor itself. Again, I didn't say much about it, but you can learn a lot from just knowledge about these excitations. You learn a lot about what's actually going on in the superconductor, what kind of pairing symmetries you have, what kind of Cooper pairs you have. Also, this type of physics has pointed, and continues to point, the way for high-energy physics. The Higgs mechanism is a famous example which was built on ideas born in the realms of superconductivity by Anderson in particular. That ends part two of my lecture. This is a little bit more abstract, maybe. Any questions about this, despite the late hour? Yes?
What is the relation with the story with are these excitons also called bound particles sometimes? What is the relation with the Hell equations, something like that?
Which equation? They're sometimes called quasi particles. Usually, I think you could do that. Yes, yeah, they are not actual particles. They're excitations of a superconductor. But then again, even the electrons and the holes, even in a semiconductor or in an insulator, are also excitations of the ground state. They're just excitations which are a little bit closer in nature to what the stuff was originally built from. But in principle, you should always think of electrons and holes as excitations where you just change the number of electrons by one more or one less. In that sense, they are just as exotic as these excitons. They're bosons, of course. In that sense, they are very different also. Okay, now the switch this one off and move to part three. We won't do part two, four. And there's a long and a short version of part three. I probably won't even make all the way through the short version of it, but we'll see. That's not necessary. So, materials with novel electronic properties, part three. Strontium titanate, and now we'll talk polarons in quantum liquids. So polarons is yet another example of a composite particle, because this is what I want you to take home from this course, that composite particles really exist. And if you want to think about how light interacts with composite particles, or with, it's not because the light interacts with each individual component, or maybe it is in the end, but it is much easier to think of light interacting with the entire thing, rather than with its components separately. The take-home message about strontium titanate is it's a unique model system for mobile interacting polarons. So you'll learn very soon what those are. The electrons of polarons in the strontium titanate are slower than the lattice vibrations. That's why we call them polarons, and they have a mass enhancement. So So they become heavier because of that, 2.5 times. The interaction between those polarons is different now from the interaction between the electrons because they are really, because they're composite, they don't interact with each other in the same way anymore. And so this new interaction is actually responsible for superconducting pairing, but also for a T-square relaxation rate by polaron scattering, and that's actually shown in these two columns. Here you see 1 over tau, the scattering rate, or inverse lifetime, as a function of temperature, different dopings, and it's T-square. Actually, the fits and the data are together with the data, they're T-square fits. This is TC in this compound, and this is superconductors, but very low TCs of 300 millikelvin at most, but as a function of, and it actually depends strongly on the density of carriers. So that was found by Koons, or say data collected by Koons in 1967. Strontium, let me see, is not so important, it sits here. Titanium sits there, so titanium actually has 4 electrons, and in this compound, it's actually 4+ ion. You can see it right away. Oxygen is 2-, yeah? 3 of those makes 6-. Strontium here is 2+, so that leaves 4+ for the titanium, so indeed, you expect it to be a nice insulator in the stoichiometric form. But then, if you substitute niobium on the titanium place, so you replace this one by niobium, for each substituted atom, you put in 1 extra electron as well. So these are donor levels, and so that's the way, one of the ways you dope them. There are alternative methods. You can also substitute lanthanum on the strontium, does exactly the same thing here. Or you can reduce the oxygen, which is also a very commonly used way, and it works also very well. Another reason why in recent years this became a hit, and it's 2008, 8 years ago now in Geneva, it was found by the group of Triscone that if you make 2-dimensional layers of strontium titanate, you take an insulating strontium titanate together with insulating lanthanum aluminate, that at the interface it not only becomes conducting, but actually becomes superconducting, and again the TC is about 300 millikelvin at most as a function of doping. But this is purely two-dimensional. It's really two-dimensional in the same way that you have two-dimensional electron gases like in gallium arsenide. So this is the first truly two-dimensional, quantum two-dimensional superconducting system with still a pretty high TC. Now, what caused the superconductivity and what causes the T-square resistivity in this compound? Well, we begin with a little band structure theory here. So the band structure of strontium titanate, and in particular the band structure above the Fermi energy, so above the gap, so the first bands that you start to occupy if you dope electrons in it, there are 3 of those. Those are the states which are actually empty D states, 3D states of the titanium. There are 5 in principle of those bands, but there are 2 of them which are 2 electron volt higher in energy, so there's 3, the so-called T2Gs, that are important for this compound. They're slightly split in the zone center because of spin orbit coupling, and there's a very small crystal field coupling here also. So this is what these bands look like. Now you can calculate, as a function from the band calculations, you can actually calculate, I didn't do these calculations, I was collaborating with Mazin for that, but we did a lot more, and so that's why I'm on that. You can calculate at which doping you start to occupy this band and that band. Of course, at 0 doping, you occupy the lowest one, and the next one, you occupy the doping of 6 × 10⁻¹⁷ per centimeter cube, and this one at 4.5 × 10⁻¹⁹ per centimeter cube. We will only explore the part where you have this band occupied or these 2 occupied. So the dopings are typically very low where you see superconductivity, and this is what the Fermi surface would look like. They're sort of like C star, you know, very small, and with these strange arms, that's the Fermi surface, and then these spheres are the other 2 bands if you go as far as 2% doping. Now, if you have these nice Fermi surfaces, you might want to do quantum oscillations experiments. So quantum oscillations are done in many, many kinds of different ways. The Hassan-Alphen is one of them. And actually, the quantum oscillations, you measure the frequency as a function of 1 over the magnetic field of peaks in the resistance or in whatever you have, in Nernst effect. And those frequencies correspond to frequencies whereby an electron turns around the Fermi energy once. And so around the Fermi surface once. So there's an Onsager relation which relates those frequencies directly to the area of Fermi surface around which the electron circulates. So actually, from these frequencies, you can directly measure sections in the Fermi surface that are, say, extremal Fermi surface sections, like like in this case, it would be this kind of orbits around the Fermi surface or around these circles. Those things you would actually see as resonances in these experiments, like over here. Now, there was a problem with this one that was never understood until we did our calculation, and we found that it had to do with cutting the Fermi surface precisely for the doping where it was done, had to do with this kind of resonance here. So that fitted precisely the description. Then there were more quantum oscillation experiments done. So this actually solved an old problem. This was never understood since 79 until we did this new band calculation, and this one fitted perfectly. Then the group of Benia did more quantum oscillation experiments for many different dopings, also very low ones where you're deep inside this gap. And actually, from the fact that at this very low doping, 10 to the 17, there's only one frequency is seen as a function of 1 over b. And now they go to a little higher doping, you start to see more oscillations superimposed, the two frequencies. This is actually where the Fermi surface moved from there into the region where you have now two bands occupied. So now you have extremal orbitals around of the orange type and one of the red type. They're two superimposed. So they mapped that out and actually showed that this critical value was also indeed what it, close to what we calculated. Now, what about the band? So this Wien code calculation just is very good. That's just what I want to say. Now, what about the bandwidths and the effective mass of the quasi-particles? So these are quasi-particles. So we did optical spectroscopy on this compound. And these are many different dopings. And let's just concentrate, first of all, on a doping with 0.02 electrons per formula unit. What you see here is this purple line. There is a very nice Drude peak, very sharp. And then there's this little bump over here. And this is actually a phonon. There's an optical phonon in this compound, just as we had in magnesium oxide. But this phonon has a frequency which is extremely low, and which is very strongly depending on the amount of niobium. There's a lot to say about it, which I will not, although you might, some of you might be intrigued by this. But if you reduce the doping, you go to, let's say, 0.1%. It's now this yellow one, and it's actually gone down to 2 millielectron volt. At the same time, also, you see the Drude peak becomes much narrower, and it loses a lot of intensity. And that's because there are 20 times fewer electrons in this graph than in this graph. And so, because of our sum rule, we know that this peak should become 20 times weaker. And if there are no electrons at all in this compound, then this peak should disappear altogether. Yeah? Now, this is the same graph, but shown on a different energy scale. This goes from 0 to 10 millielectron volt. This goes from 0 to about 3.5 electron volt. This is actually the band gap that I showed before already, just the beginning of it. And here you see a lot of intensity, huge stuff sitting there between on the order of a few tenths of an electron volt. So what is this? This is also strongly depending on doping. You see, you put in more carriers, and actually intensity increases a lot from here to there, just as this intensity increases from there to there. But clearly, it's not a Drude peak. It's something else. The other thing, just look at the vertical scale. Here we go to 60 kilosiemens per centimeter. That's the kind of unit that the optics people use for optical conductivity. And this one goes to 0.14. So the scale here is much smaller than that one. But this one is much narrower than that. So actually, if you integrate the spectral weight here and there, they're about the same, as a matter of fact. Now, this has to do with the self-trapping by electron-phonon coupling. I already showed you the mattress before. And it's the same mattress, but now there's one particle here. And so it just can sink in and then gain a little bit of deformation energy, where alpha is the mattress constant. So minus half e squared, that's actually what we call a polaron. An electron that forms, that actually sinks in the mattress, that actually forms a deformation around it. And if it moves, it moves together with the deformation. So that's no longer an electron. It's an electron. There's something to it. And so this is here, De Vreese is the world's specialist in polarons. He knows everything about it. And he very quickly, when he knew these data, he cooked up a model. He actually took our band calculations, which was ab initio. He took known electron-phonon coupling constants, which also came from experiment. There was no fitting involved of any kind, nothing. And he calculated these red curves. Now, they are not perfectly on the experimental curves, but they are close. Considering there is no fitting involved of any kind, he got very, very close. And even some of the double structure that we see, oh, sorry, this is the experiment. There's a double structure over here that's partly also reproduced by the experiment. So since this is a polaron theory and it is an experiment, I would say that these curves show that clearly we are actually seeing polarons. I'll say a bit more about what polarons are. But first of all this, we come back to the sum rule. Optical conductivity has a Drude peak at zero frequency if you have electrons. We call that the coherent part of the spectral wave. Now, if you have polarons, there is actually this second part, very strange part that I just showed, which contains also a lot of spectral wave, about half of it. This also has to do with the free electrons in your system, but it is not, it's not a Drude peak. So what is it? Well, it has to do with the fact that if you try to excite electrons with light, and you try to move them from one side to the other, that actually if you move the electron from one side to the other, it, on the neighboring side, it once again has to form its polarization cloud around it. And so every time you move it, it will co-excite phonons. It will co-excite vibrations. And this is what's happening here. You see the co-excitation of the vibrations as the electrons are moved back and forth in the lattice to which they are coupled. And then you have interband, of course. Now, the F-sum rule tells us if you integrate all this stuff together, we get just the number of free electrons in the system. Yeah. Now, it also says if we only take this part and we don't integrate over interbands, then we don't see the core electrons anymore. We just see the band electrons. And now the mass here should actually be the band mass. And this should be just the number of free electrons that you have. So this would be the 0.2% or 0.1% of carriers in the system. The coherent spectral weight, it says, would be the same number density, but now divided by a mass which is an effective mass. And this is interesting because together here, there's a certain amount of energy, spectral weight. Here we have about half of the spectral weight. Now, how can you get half the spectral weight over here with, by comparing these two formulas? That would require that M star is about twice as big as M0. So this goes in the same direction. This here is the spectral weight, the coherent spectral weight of your composite particle, of your polaron. Since it's a composite particle, it doesn't have the same dynamical mass anymore. It's actually heavier. It's not you can say that it has to carry around something with it, because it's not carrying around actual ions with it, but it is carrying around with it the fact that if it moves, sits here, it will have a lattice distortion around it. Now it moves over there. Now this lattice distortion has been relaxed, but it has to form a new lattice distortion over here. You can imagine that actually moving around with all these lattice distortions around you just is not so easy going as just in vacuum. And that makes it heavier. Heavier means there is less spectral weight in the coherent part of it, and that spectral weight has to go somewhere, and actually it goes over there, namely it goes in the co-excitation of photons with the motion, of phonons with the motion. And so if you co-excite phonons, then you have to pay that energy to those phonons, and that gives rise to this extra peak over here. And that's what we see in the experiment also. So this is what this is my, the way I imagine, I try to you also to imagine a polaron. An electron is a point particle, has charge minus E, and it's really a point. Although I used a small green blob to show it because, yeah, points are not visible. But it's really very a small thing. This here is it's a fluffy ball. You know, it's a point is sitting in the middle somewhere, hidden by this lattice distortions around it. And actually that thing is moving around as you move around your polaron in your system. And so that makes it heavier also. So what about this coherent part? Well, it's just given by the sum rule formula again. Pi n e square over m star gives you this area over there. So all we have to do is measure the area, multiply with the known factors, and we get n, as we did before. And if you do that, you get these yellow blobs, this is what you would get if there would be no mass ionization. This is what the band theory tells you. So this actually gives you a, this is n-effective, sorry. The n-effective, which is more than 2 times bigger than the actual number of electrons. And so this difference is explained by the difference in mass. This actually tells you that m star is about 2.5 times the free electron mass or the band mass of your system. This is also seen from other experiments. If you do specific heat experiments, it measures the density of states at the Fermi energy. Now, if you make your band, if you make the electrons heavier, the electron bands become narrower, and the density of states at the Fermi energy will go up by a factor of 2. And that's exactly, so this is the band structure calculations for density of states for different samples. This is where you, the measured value from specific heat goes. Again, it's about 2, there's a bit of scatter, but it's about 2 times bigger. You can do photoelectron spectroscopy and measure the band dispersion directly. And again, this is the theory, the band theory dispersion. This is what you actually see in the experiment. And so there's a factor of 2 smaller. Again, goes in the same direction. You can do Nernst quantum oscillations, I already mentioned it, and then look at the temperature dependence of it. And the temperature dependence of the Nernst oscillations, of the quantum oscillations, also give you a mass, which is about 1.83 times the free electron mass, which also corresponds to this same factor as about 2, even a bit more. So if you put all that together as a function of doping, you find for specific heat, a density of states, which is in reality higher than what you expect for electrons not coupled to phonons. If you do optics, then you find a plasma frequency square, which is the effective density divided by the mass, where the optics is, falls below the calculation, which also requires a higher mass. And if you, for these two experiments, calculate the effective mass as a function of doping, you find this kind of trend, this one outlier. So the mass starts to come down for higher and higher carrier concentrations, then it becomes more and more like a normal metal, and it's very low doping, it goes up to even 3 times. So they're quite a bit heavier, but not extremely heavy, but still quite a bit heavier. Now, if you put in those numbers and you put it in a universal graph that actually goes back to Richard Feynman for polarons, then you say, okay, if the mass reionization is a factor 3, this is a log-log plot, it would require an electron-phonon coupling term, which is about 2.5. And then this you can actually, this would mean that it is a relatively strongly coupled electron-phonon system, but not extremely. It's not in this limit. We have small polarons, this is what one calls large polarons. Now, there is a peculiar consequence to, there are a couple of peculiar consequences. So, one of them is, if you now think, you know, you've, if you did solid-state physics, you have probably been brainwashed by model where you say, okay, everything that happens in a solid is slower than the Fermi velocity of the electrons. The electrons, we start with electrons which are extremely rapid. The Fermi energy is 5 electron volts. Phonon energies are 50 millielectron volts or less. And so the phonons are a lot slower than the electrons, roughly speaking. Yeah? But here we have the opposite situation. Actually, the Fermi energy in doped strontium titanate is extremely small. It's on the 60 millielectron volt or lower range. Yeah, even less. It's 30 if you take the mass ionization. Now, the phonon frequencies are anywhere between 0 and 70 millielectron volt. And actually, it turns out that the coupling, this alpha, is mostly to this phonon at 70 millielectron volt. So we have slow electrons coupled to fast phonons. It's precisely the opposite situation. So what happens here is, indeed, these electrons move around, and they move around so slowly and so that actually it's possible for the ions to follow the motion of the electrons as they move through the lattice. So the picture that I just used when I talked about why the mass is big because it has to pull in the atoms around, this is indeed applicable here. That picture is not applicable to aluminum because the electrons move so fast that the phonons don't have the time to follow that. And so that's what one calls the adiabatic regime, whereas this is what one calls the anti-adiabatic regime. You just have a different kind of physics. There's another peculiar consequence. And that has to do with the interactions. So normally you would say, okay, electrons interact with each other through the Coulomb interaction, right? So that's the most strongest one present, and there may be some electron phonon on top of that. But here, since these are these fluffy balls moving around, you have to think about how fluffy balls, I think I skip a few here. No, I'm skipping too much. I'm not going to skip that. So one other thing. I'll come back to the fluffy balls. If you now calculate the mean free paths just from the transport in these compounds, these are experimental parameters as a function of temperature for different dopings, different curves and different dopings, and you multiply the mean free paths with the Fermi wavelength, so it's mean free paths divided by Fermi wavelength, you find that the mean free paths is about 100 times the Fermi wavelength at low temperatures. So it means that actually the electrons or these polarons are still in a very clean limit. It's not as if you have these polarons. Sometimes people think, oh, polarons are things that are trapped in impurity sites. If that were true, then these numbers would be down to about 1. That doesn't apply here. They are actually free propagating Bloch-like particles, propagating Bloch-like fluffy balls. Yeah? And then you warm up, and then, of course, at 100 Kelvin, this becomes a very small number now. Now, if you now look at the resistivity, it's T square, and T square is known for a long time already to be the standard signature of Fermi liquid behavior. Why do you get Fermi liquid behavior? That's a long story I'm not going to tell you, but it's known for many metals. So lithium, for example, pure lithium, has a T square resistance and at low temperatures, and that's normally attributed to the Coulomb interaction. Although, actually, there's one paper of 1981 by Alan MacDonald who said, actually, in many of these metals, the most important interaction is not Coulomb, but is actually phonon-mediated electron-electron interaction already. Now, what I want to say here is, in the case of polarons, it is for sure dominated by phonon-mediated interaction. It's not Coulomb. It's the fluffy ball seeing another fluffy ball, and thus the fluffy things are overlapping. So surely you have in this compound a very nice T-square behavior. This is resistivity as a function of T square. It all gives straight lines. You can do optical conductivity and measure the width of these peaks. This gives you 1 over tau, and that gives nice T square as well. And so this is the 1 over tau as a function of temperature, and it follows precisely this T square law. So it's really Fermi liquid behavior. You can relate that and calculate from Fermi liquid theory what the coupling parameter is, which would be needed for it, and gives you a lambda of order 0.1 to 0.4, depending on where you are in doping. Now we come to the fluffy balls. So this is actually what you should imagine, yeah? But now the quantum version of it, which is always difficult to imagine. Those things are quantum fluctuating as well. But you have all these balls sitting there nicely together. And now you should try to imagine where are the pairs in this. If it goes superconducting, you start to form pairs. To the eye, very little will change, because they are really close to each other. These are a situation where you have many Cooper pairs overlapping. So you should imagine that, okay, there's a pair here now, and a pair there now, a pair there now. But a few seconds later, nanoseconds later or so, or picoseconds later, this one will be paired with that one, or with that one. Yeah? But this is what these pairs are. It's a superposition of pairs, even on longer distances, that exist for a short while. And they strongly overlap with other pairs. In any case, if you just apply BCS theory for that, you find that the number of that the pairs overlapping is of the order 10 to the 6 as a function of doping. So 1 million pairs overlap with each other pair. Now, you can also use TC to calculate these coupling constants, and if you do that, you find for the coupling constants about 0.1. So actually, 0.15 is the coupling constant you get from, so is the polaron-polaron coupling constant you get from the TCs, and it's about the same value which you also get from the transport. So it's for sure, I would say it's probably the same thing which is behind both. And now I'm ready to summarize part 3. Okay, yeah. Because it goes superconducting. Oh. Yeah, and so that's a condensate of pairs. Yeah. So I really went very fast now. But Yeah.
There's a question about this larger masses coming from the third rule, because in fact you apply the limit to some way.
Yeah, yeah. That is true, yeah.
I would. Will come out of matters.
Yeah, exactly. Sorry, that's already taken into account. I maybe take it back to that point. No, there's
well,
not.
They are moving the matters, but I mean.
Well, I'll talk you through that because this is. Yeah. So, if you go from. If this spectral weight sees the electrons in the matters. This together sees the electrons out of the matters, but they're still in the periodic potential of the lattice. If you go all the way up, you take that out as well. The fact that they're still in the periodic potential of the lattice makes that the mass, even then, is different from the free electron mass. It can actually be smaller, which is even the case in stopped-on titanate. No. Which is a very confusing point, actually. That can be. So, yeah, summary of part three. So, this band structure theory, the so-called Wien code, works very well for the Fermi surface areas in the strontium titanate. Experimentally, the bands are factor 2.5 narrower, so the electrons are actually 2.5 times heavier than the Wien code prediction. And actually, from all other kinds of signatures that we have now, that's certainly the factor 2.5 you find in, or between 2 and 2.5 you find in all experiments you can do. So the electrons are slower than the lattice vibrations, and that's why we feel comfortable to talk of these things as different kind of objects, as polarons. They're really very different from electrons in aluminum. And so the interaction between those polarons is actually mediated by phonon exchange. And there you really have, you can apply this picture that I showed before the break, where you said, okay, it's two electrons lying on a mattress, and if they share the hole, they can gain a lot of energy. This is really the basic physics that drives polarons into what is also known as bipolarons, and that is what you should imagine, that gives you the superconductivity, a tendency to form pairs through that mechanism. Although they don't really get very close to your reality. This phonon-mediated polaron-polaron interaction causes superconductivity, sure. Not so very high TC, but still superconductivity. And also this T-square relaxation rate, so the Fermi-liquid behavior, in this case, has to do with electron-phonon interaction, or phonon-mediated interactions, but it has to do with electron-phonon, and not so much with the usual idea that people have, that it is Coulomb. And so that actually summarizes part 3, and part 4 we'll keep for another time. Thank you for your attention.